indifference curves. So indifference curves are the set of all points in the feasible set, that is the consumption set, at which a consumer is equally well off. So that is the consumer is indifferent between any two points on her indifference curve. So the whole idea of indifference curves comes from the concept of contours. So contours was a thing used by initial cartographers. So cartographers are people who make maps. So cartographers had a problem. The problem for cartographers was that the world was 3D, but the maps were 2D. So you had a three-dimensional world which we wanted to plot on a two-dimensional map. So it's easy to plot, here is Delhi, here is Shimla. But if you want to make a road from Delhi to Shimla, you need to know if there is some mountain in between. You need to know what is the altitude of different things. So what they started doing is, they started mapping all the points which were at the same altitude. Okay. So if you had to go from a point A to point B, okay, and the contours around point B, let's say they look like this. Something like this. So if you take a direct road from here, you'll encounter a very steep slope here. So let's say this is at 1000 meters, this is at 800 meters, this is at 600 meters, this is 400 meters. So if you make a direct road from here to here, you'll encounter a very steep slope here. So what you could do is you could go like this and then like this, so that you do not have a very high slope, because very high slope means there's a risk of accident and other kinds of risk. So that's what cartographers did. They were plotting points at the same altitude on the map. Now, initial so the same problem exists in utility functions. That is, you have three things you are discussing now: amount of good x, amount of good y, and the utility level at any bundle x and y. So ideally, if you want to look at what utility is at different points, you would like to look at a three-dimensional function, x and y, with utility on the z-axis. But that is not feasible, because again, the screen is two-dimensional, the paper is two-dimensional, our reading materials are all two-dimensional. So that's why we came up with this idea of using contours in our consumption set, and the contours, they came to be known as indifference curves. But instead of mapping, instead of highlighting points on different altitudes, you are now going to highlight points at the same utility level. So let's say this is utility level 100. Then there's another contour for utility level 200. There's another contour for utility level 50 or 30. Okay, so these are going to be different contours. So if there are two points, x1, y1 and x2, y2 on the same indifference curve, it basically means that x1, y1 is indifferent to x2, y2. What it also means is utility at x1, y1 is equal to utility at x2, y2. That's indifference curves. Now, certain properties of indifference curves, they are downward sloping. They are downward sloping if both commodities are goods. So generally we are used to saying that everything is a good, but in economics, goods are something which you like more of, and bads are something which you like less of. So the set of commodities is really divided into two things: goods and bads. Goods could be things like food, entertainment, it could be sofa sets, it could be cars, it could be alcohol. Bads could be pollution, it could be working, studying, or it could be alcohol. Okay, really depends on who you are. Okay, so depending on your person, a particular good might be a particular commodity might be a good or a bad. But generally we consider all commodities to be goods, but in certain situations we'll not consider all commodities to be goods. So when we are considering all commodities to be goods, we say that the indifference curves have to be downward sloping. The reason is, if indifference curves are not downward sloping, that is, let's say they are upward sloping like this, then I am saying you give me more of both goods and I am still indifferent. Okay, so if the two goods are, let's say, pizza and burger, starting from this point, you give me more of pizza, you give me more of burger, and I am still indifferent. That can't be happening. Okay, so they have to be downward sloping, in the sense that if you take away burgers from me but give me pizzas in return, I am somewhat compensated for the loss in burgers. So the exact amount of compensation which makes me indifferent between the two situations will give you the position of the indifference curve. So that's why indifference curves are downward sloping. But if, let's say, one of the commodities is a bad, let's say this is your earnings and this is the number of hours you work. So let's say this is one point, some point, where you are earning 100 rupees and you are working for 5 hours. Now if you want to earn more, okay, if you are giving me more money, if the employer is giving me more money, I am okay with working more hours. So for 150 bucks, I am okay with working 6 hours. So this is what, if I am indifferent between these two points, this is what my indifference curve will look like, something like this. So indifference curves are upward sloping when one of the commodities is bad. Okay. So when you have both commodities as goods, this is what the ICs will look like. It will be increasing in this direction. Utility is increasing in this direction. You go higher and higher, the higher indifference curves represent higher utility. Okay. Here we'll have ICs which will look like this. Which direction points to, let's say this is earnings and this is hours work. So this is the good and this is the bad. Which direction is utility increasing, right or left? Left. So you're saying this point is, so you're saying increasing in this direction. So this is, let's say, utility 50 and this is utility 60. No, for the same hour work, these two are points on the same hour work. So on the same hour work, more earnings means higher utility. So utility has to be increasing in this direction. All right, what will the indifference curves look like if both commodities are bad? Downward sloping, so same as this case?
Concave.
Concave. So you are saying it will be downward sloping, but like this.
They won't be in consumption.
No, that's true. what you consume is a different matter altogether. The indifference curves exist irrespective of what point you choose. Mera indifference curve rahega. I will consume this point. That's true. Okay, I will continue to consume this point. That's okay. But all I am saying is ki indifference curve will have to exist. I am just saying don't focus on what point you'll consume for now. Just focus on what will the indifference curve look like.
How?
That's okay. So what she's saying is ki you have 5 or 6 sandwiches, after that if somebody is thrusting sandwiches down your throat, they start behaving as bad. Alright, cool. So after some point both the sandwich and the samosa has become a bad for you. My question is, in this phase, what does the indifference curve, what do the indifference curves look like? That's all I'm asking. Do they have to be, they are going to be downward sloping. Everybody agrees to that, or does anybody have a doubt with that, why they need to be downward sloping? Everybody is okay with that? So the question is, if they are downward sloping, are they same as the red case? Is it same as the two goods case? Is utility still increasing upwards? No. So the only difference is, from the red case, the utility will be increasing downwards. Whether it looks like this or not is a different matter. It may look like concave or convex or straight lines, but the only thing is, which you can say for sure, is now utility will be increasing in this direction, and that is why you will consume zero amount of goods, both goods. Okay? So let's say you are stuck with just two bads. Okay, let's say there is no other commodity to choose, then you are going to do zero amounts of both things. Okay. So that's what we need to remember, that it is downward sloping when both are goods and it is downward sloping when both are bad. The only difference is, when both are goods, utility increases upwards. When both are bad, utility increases downwards. And this becomes the point that gives you the highest utility somehow. So you would ideally want to consume zero amounts of this. So that will depend on the particular utility function. So it could be concave, convex, it could be concave. So it could even be straight line. I can say utility is equal to minus x minus y. I'm saying both goods are bad. You can say utility is minus under root xy. Again, both goods are bad. You can say utility equals to minus x square minus y square. Again, both goods are bad. But when you plot these curves, you see that this is straight line, this is convex, and this is concave. They are all cases of both goods being bad. What it will signify will become clearer later on. What are the benefits of using convexity? But as far as exam is concerned, we are only interested in the math of it. Why we use convexity is because it has been found that in a lot of cases people prefer average bundles. So that's why a lot of times economists like to assume convexity results. Also, one very good thing which comes out of convexity is Lagrangian gives you the correct result. You can use optimization techniques correctly when you use convexity. As we'll see in the next lecture, if you dilute your convexity assumptions, you can no longer use Lagrangian. Okay, so that's the only thing. Yeah. Yeah.
Then we won't prefer the average curve.
No, not talking about bads. I'm saying about goods, why we say convex. In goods, convexity is preferred because of Lagrange. In bads, again, you are going to do this thing. So Lagrange fails if you have bads. Lagrange fails if you do not have convexity. So you are going to assume everything is a good. You are going to assume that convexity is there, and you're going to assume a bunch of other things to make sure Lagrangian works.
So if we are assuming that the convexity of preferences is there, then in the case where both the roots are bad bats, the shape of the IC should be
concave. Yeah. So if both the commodities are bad, alright. So if both commodities are bad, then this is an IC. Utility is increasing in this direction. Your indifference between these two points, you plot any line, so any point here will be on a higher utility. Okay, so yes, this point will be more preferred. But generally, we do not talk about both goods being bad because the solution is pretty obvious in that case that you will always produce this point. There's no scope for asking you any math, but what they do ask sometimes is the shape of utility function. The shape of indifference curves. Okay, so yeah, that's a good point that if you are saying that preferences are convex, okay, then if preferences are convex, that is you are preferring the average bundle, then the shape of your ICs, it becomes concave if both the commodities are bad. Okay, so if this is a bad and this is a bad. Second property, one through each point. So there will be exactly one indifference curve passing through each point. So assume not. So let us prove this by contradiction. Assuming there are multiple indifference curves passing through these points. So there's a U1 utility function and a U2 utility indifference curve, both passing through point. Okay. Now we are assuming both commodities are goods. Okay. So the strict monotonicity property. The strict monotonicity property says that more is preferred. Okay, so monotonicity basically means that if both commodities are goods, if you consume more of both goods, you are definitely going to be better off. So if XA is greater than XB and YA is greater than YB, then point A is going to be strictly preferred to point B. If I gave you more of both burger and pizza, you are definitely going to be happy. That's strict monotonicity. It is not valid always, like the case with which Aarti pointed out that I like only 5 burgers and 5 pizzas. If you give me any more burgers after 5 burgers and 5 pizzas, I do not want to consume anything more. So after a point, giving me more amount of pizzas and burger will not make me happier. So in that case, monotonicity is violated. Okay, but strict monotonicity property, it says that if both the commodities, they are increased in quantity, then you're definitely going to prefer that particular product. By strict monotonicity, I can see that bundle C has been constructed in such a way that it is preferred to bundle D. So bundle C has more of both X and Y, so C is strictly preferred to bundle D. At the same time, you have bundle A being preferred to bundle B. Also, D and A have been constructed on the same IC. So you have D indifferent to A. So by this entire logic, you get C strictly preferred to D, indifferent to A, strictly preferred to B. So by transitivity, you can say that C is strictly preferred to B. But as you can see, C and B lie on the same indifference curve U2. So you should instead have had C indifferent to B. Now both these things cannot be true simultaneously, because that would be a violation of which property? sorry, no, these both these things, if they are true, which property is violated?
Completeness.
So it will be a violation of completeness, which is not allowed, and that's why our initial assumption that there are multiple ICs passing through point E is contradicted. So the third property, convexity. So this property simply states that if preferences are convex, again this property applies if preferences are, if preference is convex. Then the indifference curve would also be convex. So here's what convexity property says: if preferences convex implies utility function quasi concave, implies indifference curves convex. Now firstly I look at what does it mean for a curve to be convex. Okay, we all know this property of convex curves, that if you connect any two points on the curve with a line segment, the segment lies completely above the curve. If you do not, like, this is the definition of a convex curve. So you need to remember that there are going to be different definitions for convexity. Preferences will have a different definition for convexity, a function will have a different definition for convexity, and a curve will have a different definition of convexity, and you need to remember all these three definitions. Okay, so all these things have different definitions for convexity. They might look similar, but they are going to be different. So a curve being convex means when you connect any two points on the curve, the line segment lies above the curve. Okay, so if you want to imagine a convex curve in three dimension, imagine a kadhai. Okay, that's a convex curve. You connect any two points on the kadhai, that point will lie above the kadhai. And if you want to imagine a concave curve in three dimension, invert the kadhai. Okay, kadhai ko ulta kar do, then you connect any two points on the inverted kadhai, the line segment will lie below the kadhai. Okay, so place a spoon on the spoon becomes the line segment, and it flies above the kadai, so it's a convex curve. So kadai is a convex curve, inverted kadai is a concave curve. Okay, so here we just have two dimensions, but whatever we are saying, this definition of convexity, this definition of convexity, this is not restricted to two dimension or three dimension or any dimension. This is generally true. Okay, even though we cannot imagine what a line segment in 10 dimension would mean like, but that does not restrict the definition. The definition holds in any dimension, because our consumption world could be any dimension. It depends on how many goods you are considering to buy. If you are considering 100 goods, then your consumption bundle belongs to R to the power 100. Okay, so the definitions that we study should hold for any dimension. Okay, so what is, so convexity implies that if this curve is convex, means if you connect any two points on this segment, if you connect any two points with the segment, all points on that segment, they lie above the IC. Okay, now why this holds true is because these two points lie on an AC. So let me call this point as A, this point as B. So if A and B lie on an IC, I can claim that A is indifferent to B. Okay, if A is indifferent to B and preferences are convex, then what can I say about point C? It will be strictly preferred to both A and B. Okay, and I know that all points above this IC are at a higher utility, they are more preferred points. Okay, so the relationship checks out. C is strictly preferred to A and B, and C lies above my IC. Both these statements are logically equivalent. Okay, so that's my convexity of indifference curves.